Thank you so much.
Thank you very much for this very distinguished honor. And I wish to pay tribute to Patricia Goldman Rakish very first, because I am going to give a talk along his lines. I am not a clinician, I am not a doctor, I am a scientist, and after this beautiful talk on behavior, we are back to basic science and molecular biology. And Patricia had the big insight on working memory and on higher brain functions, and introduced this notion of synaptic triad, where she meant that at a given synapse, you may have a third neurotransmitter or second regulating the efficiency of the first synapse. It's a basic, if you wish, of a basic synaptic plasticity. And there is a second neurotransmitter having, for instance, an effect on dopamine. You heard this morning extensively. And what I am going to talk about is another neurotransmitter, acetylcholine, acting on the nicotinic receptor. And this is a very common neurotransmitter at the neuromuscular junction, and it is released at the chemical synapse, creates a change of electrical response, permeability to sodium and potassium ions. And the question is, what is the mechanism? The mechanism we are going to discuss now, very briefly, is what may be called an allosteric mechanism, in the sense that there is a site here for the neurotransmitter and the site for the ion channel, and there is a coupling between the two, and there is a molecular mechanism which is fundamental to signal transduction in the brain, which is mediated by this kind of conformational change. And this was initially studied in bacteria with a regulatory enzyme which control metabolic efficiency within the cell. And you have here an example of the mechanism we propose with Jacques Monod for mediating this kind of interaction between different ligands. Now, why I am going to talk about that here? Simply because I think if we really want to understand the higher brain function and dysfunctions, we have not only to understand what's happening at the molecular level, what's happening at the network level, and I will talk there about nicotine addiction and enhancement, and then to reach the highest level you heard about the whole morning, which is the ultimate behavior and access to consciousness. Now, the identification of this elementary building block, which is necessary for the development of any kind of function in the brain. And this is a scheme about the isolation of the first of this receptor for neurotransmitter, the acetylcholine receptor, using fish electric organ and snake venom toxins. And here is the first image of this very important molecule that you can see here by electron microscopy with five subunits. And if you look at closely at a higher resolution scale, you have here the shape of the molecule, and which is a transmembrane molecule. Here it recognizes the neurotransmitter, here the ion channel, and you can see that the neurotransmitter sites are far from each other, 40 angstrom, and even much farther from the ion channel, which is under the control of acetylcholine, 60 angstrom. So we are dealing with a system where we have, within the same molecule, the neurotransmitter controlling indirectly through a conformation change the opening of the ion channel. So this is, again, the basic building block of all the circuits we have in our brain. Now, the interesting thing is that this was the first, quite a while ago, and a lot of studies were done to try to elucidate the atomic structure of the receptors through X-ray crystallography. And unfortunately, the receptor from either electric organ or brain appeared extremely difficult to crystallize and identify by X-ray crystallography. Fortunately enough, we discovered, this was Bocquet and Pierre-Jean Coringer in my laboratory, that some invertebrates, some bacteria, here Greek, are compounds which have a very similar structure as acetylcholine nicotinic receptor. So we identified the X-ray structure here, and also Hilfendoxler from this bacteria. And then subsequently, other groups identified the receptor for glutamate, for GABA, for serotonin, and here, very last, nicotinic receptor itself. So we have now the atomic structure of this elementary building block involved in the signal transduction at the synapse. And the interesting thing for this ligand-gated ion channel, there are many other channels, G protein link receptor, like the serotonin receptors. But here, in this case, it is extremely interesting to note that in our brain, we have molecules which, in fact, are extremely similar for molecules already present in bacteria, and therefore that our brain molecules derive from bacterial cells. Maybe you never thought about that, but this is what evolution tells us. Now, the most interesting feature for the pharmacologist of these receptors is that they are not only the active site, like the acetylcholine binding site and the ion channel, but in addition, there are other categories of sites which has been discovered with this receptor. And here, a site for ivermectin. You may know that it's used against helminths, and is a very potent pharmacological agent. And you can see here that this compound enhances dramatically the efficiency of the nicotinic receptor, and that the site is again neither the acetylcholine site nor the ion channel, but another site located at the boundary with the lipids. And here is the site for ivermectin as a typical allosteric modulator. So this is a new category of pharmacological agent. You heard about the nicotine agonist, antagonist, about the serotonin agonist and antagonist, and now you are facing with a new category of drug which is ongoing and being developed against brain disease. Now, this is not only true for ivermectin, but many other compounds, and in particular, the general anesthetics that all of you may use during surgery are also allosteric modulators, but located now here in a small pocket in the transmembrane domain of this acetylcholine receptor. So we are facing a new pharmacology where tens and dozens of new compounds are being developed currently in the pharmacology of brain disease and in particular of mental disease. Now, the last things I want to show with this receptor is that one can study at the atomic level and in the microsecond time scale the allosteric transition between the open and closed state of the ion channel. Here is the molecular dynamics which have been achieved, and the very interesting finding is that this is taking place in a microsecond time scale. So it's very fast, much faster than the psychological time scale you heard about today. But the most fascinating thing is, nevertheless, that this is constraining the speed of propagation of impulsion within our brain. Our brain is not a computer working at the speed of light. It's a machine working at the speed of sound. Why is it so slow? Because of this transition of this molecular receptor. So this is an important constraint on cognition. Going up from the molecular level, I am now going to the network level, and at the network level, of course, talk about one of the main actions of nicotine on the brain, nicotine addiction, and this is a very interesting effect because here it's a good example where a compound can be bad, being creating addiction. Another situation where it is good because it's a nicotinic enhancer. And here you can see the scheme where nicotine is acting on nicotinic receptor present in the ventral tegmental area, the dopamine. You heard a lot about the dopaminergic presentation today, but you have not to forget that this regulation of dopamine release is under the control of other receptors, and in particular, the nicotinic receptor here. And the reason why you have this effect on drug addiction is due to the relationship between the dopaminergic system and the nicotinic receptor present on the dopaminergic system in particular. Here I show that there are several species of nicotinic receptor subunit, and if we want to develop a drug, which after all is what is the aim in the psychopharmacology, we have to deal with the subunit composition of these receptors within the brain, and the main result that we achieved recently about in administration is that we can, in the mouse, reproduce self-administration of nicotine, and you can here have the curve of self-administration of nicotine. Now, we may knock out the nicotinic receptor subunit. Here is a beta subunit. And when you remove the delta subunit, then there is a loss of self-administration. And very interestingly, if you re-inject a vector expressing the beta to subunit, then you recover the self-administration. So there is a necessary sufficient condition to have nicotine self-administration is the presence of this nicotinic receptor in there, in the ventral tegmental area. And moreover, I show you the last finding, is that there is a subunit composition of the receptor which is present here in the VTA, which is involved in the addictive property of the nicotine in the brain. So if, and we are presently developing new modulators of this nicotinic receptor with the hope to find, and there are some already compounds under test to fight against self-administration. The last thing I want to show about this is that, as I said, nicotine is a dual use. It's a bad use in the sense that it creates addiction, but on the other hand, it is a cognitive enhancer. And here is a summary of the social interaction, which is a very artificial and simplified system for the mouse. And you can see that, there is here a quite significant difference in the knockout mice for the DV2 subunit and the social interaction in the mouse. In addition, if we re-express the beta subunit here in the prefrontal cortex, which was carefully studied and extensively studied by Patricia Goldman-Rakish, then we can restore the social relationship by re-expression of the beta subunit. So there is a way to investigate the dual use of compounds, the positive and the negative effects of nicotine in the brain and I hope in human as well. My last point deals with a higher level of organization. As I said, I went from the molecule to the network to the higher function, consciousness, and to bring a long story short, together with my student and now colleague, Stanislas Dehaene, 20 years ago, we proposed an idea that the global space where the conscious synthesis is taking place in the brain involves long-range connectivity and long-range connectivity and the long-range connectivity is, of course, useful to link the different territories of the cerebral cortex, in particular, into a single physical space where conscious synthesis may take place. This is very similar to the proposal made by Patricia Goldman-Rakish for working memory, and it involves mainly the prefrontal cortex and the parieto-temporal cingulate cortex. So it's a big network we have in our brain where, say, conscious processing may take place. And this was formalized. We propose a way to try to implement the access to consciousness through this kind of very simple minded skill with upward and connectivity and downward feedback reafference, which correspond to the invasion of the cerebral cortex to conscious stimulus. So this kind of reaction called ignition, there is a certain kind of burning out of the, it's analogy of the neuron in the conscious space, then there is, as you shall see, this kind of reaction with a self-sustained kind of reaction, which has been confirmed recently by the group of Rolf Sema. And this is a masking task, and here also, and you can see here the invasion of the cerebral cortex by the conscious processing. And the interesting thing is that we found it in the mouse, and that there are some ultra-slow fluctuations that we believe are analogous to these ignition steps. And the interesting thing is that not only they are altered by general anesthetics and therefore linked with conscious processing, but also altered by nicotinic receptor. So there is a relationship here between nicotinic receptor and conscious processing. And I want to establish and to close and please this audience, if I may say, that we think there is a relationship with schizophrenia and hypofrontality, since, as you can see here, there are predisposition genes to schizophrenia and smoking. This is from a human clinical, extensive clinical studies that we have not done, where this gene is pointed out. Now, we have been able to identify it as being present on interneuron, GABAergic neuron in the cerebral cortex. And the idea is that there is some kind of dysfunction, for instance, due to some mutation in some particular case of schizophrenia, having nicotinic receptor, modulate cortical ignition via GABAergic inhibition. So there is here a hope that instead of being a negative addictive compound, nicotine may help, in fact, the schizophrenics. And it is well known that the schizophrenics are chain smokers because maybe there is a self-medication by nicotine. Now, thank you very much for your patience. And in summary, I want to say that nicotinic receptors from the start are extraordinarily good model for interneuronal communication and can be used to develop new drugs as being specific for the resting, active, and desensitized states. There are new compounds called modulators which can be used to modulate prefrontal activity, circuits of addiction and enhancement, and that disruption of some of these disorders may have pathological consequences. Thank you very much, and sorry.
You did it, thank you.